The last speaker of the session today is Dr. Razan, Dr. Razan Qadri. Dr. Qadri is a consultant at the Department of Dermatology at King Faisal Children's Hospital, and she comes from Detroit, Michigan, United States.
I'm actually most recently trained as a procedural dermatologist, which is completely different from the subject today, but we'll do our best to give you the best overview on the past, present, and future therapies in atopic dermatitis. So to start with, atopy, as defined in the root word atopos from the Greek language, is meaning out of place. Out of place, inflammation of the skin is what we see. And as we already know, the clinical triad is of atopic dermatitis, hay fever, and asthma. What it also is a genotypic diathesis, meaning that it is the itch that rashes. So normally you have no skin lesions, they have an itch, they have a tendency to scratch it, then they get these eczematous dermatitis, which is characterized by pallor surrounded by erythematous vesiculated crusted plaques that, if left chronically, become lichenified, meaning that they become hyperlinear and darkening. And then overall, the entire body is covered with excoriation marks as well. Now, the lesion distribution is quite characteristic in that it migrates from one stage of life to the next. In infants, we see it especially involving the face, the cheeks with relative sparing of the central face, as well as marked involvement of the extensor surfaces. And as they get older and the lesions become more chronic, all these areas migrate to the flexural areas to be involved. And then you have chronic lesions, which are phenotypically correlated with lichenification. And then common to all stages of life, you see xerosis, which is commonly known as diffuse dry scaly skin, especially noted in the winter months, especially in dry regions. Now, ichthyosis is a common coexisting lesion, which is fish-like scaling of the entire skin. And then we also see involvement of the cornea sometimes, and this very unaesthetically pleasing, or displeasing actually, hyperlinearity of the skin, especially that of the face, in Denny Morgan's lines and orbital darkening. And this is some pictures. Sorry, for the sake of time, I'm speaking very quickly. What you'll see typically in an infant, in a young adult with this marked facial erythema and central facial pallor, and then this disfigurement later in life, and I'm just showing the face here, hyperlinearity, periorbital thickening, darkening of the skin that is not going to respond to any Botox or any fillers. So now, a philosophical overview of the history of how atopic dermatitis was treated. So earlier in the 15th century, Ibn Sina's Qanun fi al-Tib, in the third chapter, a chapter on beauty, actually is the closest to what we use in terms of topical therapy to treatment today, 400 years ago. What we saw, that he used moisturization as the crux for healing of the skin, and he used to recommend cleansing the area with vinegar, as we know now is a very good antiseptic for anti-staph coverage as well as fungi. And then he used to apply a compounded mixture of dirham kibrit, which is sulfur, sabr, which is aloe, or a great humectant for the skin, and some zemk, which was almond paste. And then in the 17th and 18th century, the French medical philosophy was to use this very drastic technique called Saunier-Serrouze. And the idea back then was that atopic dermatitis was actually a reflection of severe internal disease, and they had to let the disease come out with leeches. And this led to the rapid death in many patients. And it was very, very drastic, especially in infants with eczema. They used to put them in isolation wards and treat them with this method. And many of them subsequently died of what we know as sepsis. In contrast, 100 years later, the Viennese, or the German dermatologists, Heber and Kaposi, promoted the exact opposite. They promoted the therapeutic value, again, of bathing, to emphasize Ibn Sina's earlier treatments, and to topically treat the skin with sulfur. And they also emphasize, again, the utmost importance of treating the external skin with topical emollients and anti-inflammatories and antibiotic. And back then, the only antibiotic they had was sulfur. And then, as we know, the U.S.-British perspective was to use a combination of both systemic and topical therapies. So now to the present, we know that the pathogenesis, as all of you have mentioned earlier today, is crux to understanding how to treat the disease. And although we have not a complete picture about how to treat it. Even an elementary understanding is necessary to explain the rationale for our treatments. And I think it's an orchestra of cells that are involved. And the main player in atopic dermatitis is the T lymphocyte, which shows a biphasic T cell pattern. And as you see here, the undifferentiated T cell, I don't have my pointer, in the right cytokine environment will promote either Th1 lymphocyte profile with IL-12 and interferon gamma in its surrounding area, and this will lead to more chronic type of lesions. And what we see acutely actually is Th2 lymphocyte an overpopulation of Th2 lymphocytes would then progress to the upregulation of B cells that secrete IgE and eosinophils. And the major cytokine players in this is IL-4 and IL-5 and IL-13. And the Th1 interferon gamma actually inhibits Th2, and we'll see later how that falls into treatment. So in terms of immunoglobulins, as we know with asthma, there is an overproduction of IgE, and how does this do that? After cross-linking with the allergen, the IgE plays a role in type 1 hypersensitivity reactions by inducing mast cells and basophils that release histamine. And then the allergen-specific IgE activates these basal cells and mast cells by interacting with the high affinity receptor for IgE, the Fc epsilon receptor 1, located on their cell membrane. And the pruritus and erythema are present after exposure to the allergens because of the release of histamine from the mast cells. Another major player are the Langerhans cells, which are antigen-presenting cells that also express a high affinity IgE receptor on their surface. And the activation of these cells promote the activation, furthermore, of Th2, and therefore there's a positive feedback system that amplifies any response to antigen and allergen. Again, common to atopic dermatitis is eosinophilia, and again there is when the cytokine milia has IL-5 and IL-3 and GM-CSF, it promotes further Th2 lymphocyte upregulation, which leads to more eosinophilia. So again, it's a vicious cycle phenomenon. Now, last but not least is the keratinocyte, which is integral because they produce the ceramides as well as the filaggrin that was mentioned earlier. And what they found in atopic dermatitis patients, at least the dermatologists, that they have an overexpression of sphingomyelinase, which breaks down the ceramide, and it reduces the overall level of ceramide, which allows for defection of the stratum corneum barrier, and it allows for the entry of Staph aureus and other microbes. And the superantigen toxin secondary to Staph aureus induce keratinocytes to further express TNF-alpha and beta-hemolysin, which both interfere with ceramide metabolism. So our current understanding of this pathophysiology has provided us with the rationale for our therapeutic interventions, which are usually multiple agent in our management. So the first and foremost is preventative management. So how we already heard earlier about how to protect the environment of these patients. We want to decrease the microorganisms of Staph aureus, various viri, and superficial fungal infections with very meticulous hygiene. And after cleaning the area, the surface of the skin, we want to hydrate it because the decreased ceramide concentration in the skin leads to overall xerosis, which actually promotes the super infection. Again, we also want to avoid the abrasive soaps, detergents. I always recommend the patients, and it's recommended by the American Academy of Dermatology, to buy detergents that are free of formaldehyde and fragrance. Smoke, fragrances should all be avoided. And for children in particular, appropriate clipping of the nails and wearing gloves to minimize scratching. Now, the idea that dietary manipulations can improve atopic dermatitis is still present, but clinical evidence is lacking. And I think the crux and parcel of our treatment is to hydrate the skin. And what we know is the soak and smear method is while they're still standing in the shower, while their skin is still wet, although it's a very simplistic approach, it works the best, is to hydrate the skin with ceramide-rich barrier mixtures. What we have here is Epiceram by Berry Therapeutics and Trizera, which are rich in ceramide. And then, again, major player, and I'm not going to go through this so much, is the topical corticosteroids. And how does this work? It actually upregulates the level of I-kappa B-alpha, which inhibits transcription by binding with NF-kappa B. And this is prevented from entering the nucleus, which leads to overall inhibition of the transcription of various pro-inflammatory cytokines as described in this chart. And the next major player, and is probably replacing the use of topical steroids for maintenance therapy, is the topical calcineurin inhibitors. The two that we use here are tacrolimus and pimecrolimus, which are T-cell activation inhibitors. And recent studies by Dr. Paller and her group in Northwestern suggest that tacrolimus possesses superior efficacy compared with pimecrolimus in atopic dermatitis patients. And how does this occur? As we know with the oral calcineurin inhibitors, pimecrolimus or tacrolimus bind with macrophylline 12, which then inhibit or bind the calcium calmodulin complex, and it prevents the dephosphorylation of NFAT, therefore inhibiting the cytokine synthesis. So what do we do now? The International Consensus Conference on Atopic Dermatitis recommends topical corticosteroid for acute control of disease and maintenance therapy with the topical calcineurin inhibitors, and this delineates that. I know I don't have that much time left, but for mild to moderate disease, we usually use a high-potency steroid along with a calcineurin inhibitor for about 12 weeks total. Then upon clearance of the disease, we just use ceramide-rich emollients and topical calcineurin inhibitor to maintain the result. And as we heard earlier, there is upregulation of the mast cells and the basophils that lead to the release of histamine. So pruritus is alleviated by using antihistamine, and it also has an anxiolytic property that may mitigate the stress-related exacerbation of the pruritus. And as we know, we have to treat the bacterial component because 90% of atopic dermatitis lesions have co-infection with Staph aureus, so we really need to treat, even for short-term using topical agents such as mupirocin or fusidic acid, and if the disease is severe enough, we use oral antibiotic. But when all other topical fails, there's the new anti-staph strep agent Altabax named rifampicin, which is not available yet, and we hope to get it in the near future. In terms of the co-infection with fungi and viri, we have to consider prophylactic topical corticonazole formulations and to prevent life-threatening dissemination of cutaneous herpes with Famvir or Acyclovir. Now, into a totally different approach, we want to go more towards systemic therapies to prevent disease recurrence. Phototherapy has been used. We use it a lot in King Faisal, and there are studies to show that both narrowband and cold UVA or UVA1 are equally effective in treatment of patients with moderate to severe atopic dermatitis, even in as short of a span as 8 weeks treatment. However, narrowband is more useful, and shorter exposure time allows for it to be safer, and we do not have UVA1, so luckily we have the narrowband UVB, and they found that there is absolutely no systemic side effects. However, in our patient population, it's quite aesthetically unpleasing because they do get that darker photodamaged skin. So it's something that we try to use only in the most severe of cases. And of course, systemic corticosteroids are we use for rapid relief but susceptible to rebound, and the American Academy actually does recommend the use of cyclosporine for the treatment of severe atopic dermatitis. Maximal efficacy is seen usually by 2 weeks, but relapse is quite common. One of the newer medications used, and it's not a biologic, I'm going to talk a little bit about the biologics, is leflunomide, and this is a before and after picture, but it's not used commonly because it has teratogenic effects in women, and it's not safe for pediatric population. And azathioprine and Cellcept are not used also because of the long-term potential for carcinogenicity. So what we're now in the realm of the biologics, holding promise for more targeted therapy for atopic dermatitis. And in the dermatology literature, there was a most recent review article in the JAD in September 2009 that talked about Elefacept, which is the fully humanized LFA3 tip fusion protein that inhibits T-cell activation. And in a cohort of 9 cases only, when used concomitantly with narrowband, it was well tolerated, and there was absolutely no risk of superinfection noted, at least in that small cohort. Now, in terms of omalizumab, it cannot be recommended for this use in the atopic dermatitis population at this time, and there's very few studies in the dermatology literature. However, with mepolizumab, although there's only one study, 20 patients were noted to have at least a 72% response, and the side effects were mild and temporary, unlike that was seen with omalizumab. But the star of the game in the biologics, and even in our hands, this has not worked that very much that well, is the interferon gamma, which is produced by the Th1 lymphocytes that inhibits the Th2. And there's 9 publications with a total of 229 patients treated, and this had the best proven efficacy of all of them, although, again, it's all the biologics have not worked very well in the hands of dermatologists. And last but not least, I wanted to mention briefly about rituximab, where there was 6 open-label studies, but it was complicated by many, which is the anti-CD20, by many opportunistic infections. Thank you.
Thank you very much for being on time.
No, that's really on time because we followed this watch and it was just on time. Now, I would like to invite all the speakers, please. Professor Al-Faray, Dr. Suleiman Al-Hammadi, Dr. Rabi Al-Khoghet, please come and take chair. We'll have a couple of questions before we disperse for prayer and lunch. And Dr. Please join us. Sorry, yes. Please, we needed a chair here. If somebody can bring or you have a chair here or extra? Well, the young man can stand like me and the Dr. Rabi Al-Khoghet. Please come here, join me.
Yeah, we can see.
Please, Dr. Professor Kutayba, yes, please.
The question was the differences in prevalence of asthma in Saudi Arabia. There are regional differences, and whether there are genetic differences which may explain the regional variation. We did not explore that further because we started that time with limited resources and limited also staff. So I think what we concentrated on and we speculate on that time that there are differences in the environmental triggers in the different regions. So we assume that indoor and outdoor allergens may play a role, which in fact does not exclude and it may emphasize the importance of the differences in genetic differences. And I am aware of some research going on to look into those differences as regard to the genetic background.
I would just like to add what Professor Al-Faray has said, that Jizan has the highest one. And next to that, there is a place called Farasan Island, if I'm correct. Farasan Island, none of the people known to be allergic to anything. Very surprising. But in Jizan, you have a variety of different kinds of outdoor allergen, indoor allergen, including the Ganoderma, the deciduous spores kind. So I do agree that the regional environmental factors is influencing the prevalence of asthma in Saudi Arabia. Second question, please. Yes.
The humidity is very high in the eastern and western province, especially in Jizan and Farasan, and also in Dammam. is very high. Here in we know that Riyadh is very dry, so the dust mite is there, but it's not like high like the other regions.
That's a very good thing.
There are interesting to do it. It's
very inshallah, there are anecdotal history that people move from Riyadh, they get less asthma, and those who come to Riyadh, they get more asthma, because Riyadh is dry, no humidity, so we have almost negligible dust mites, but Jeddah is very high. So these, as you mentioned, as
there is one question there.
Please, Dr. Mohsin, I'm sorry. I was
no problem. First of all, thanks for all the speakers for intriguing and exciting talks. And I really enjoyed all the lectures. My question to Dr. Sleiman Al-Hammadi, who has done great work in reviewing the very complex subjects, which is genetic of asthma. With the difficulty to replicate the data, do you think studying such a disease in highly inbred population, although it is not a single gene Mendelian disease, however, having more than four or three people affected within the same family, comparing it with the control within the same family with similar genetic pools and background will add value? Maybe you are aware about that. We already have started or initiated a huge project looking at different genes in asthma. One of them, what you have alluded to, which has been also published by our speakers and international expert, Professor Qutaybah Hamid, which is ADAM33. We have looked at the ADAM33 in small sample. Now it's a pilot study. And we found actually there is novel loci in ADAM33 in asthmatic compared to control. It is very preliminary. It is promising. However, still, I think we are far beyond proofing or finding the fact. But don't you think that maybe looking at this question in highly inbred population like Saudi Arabia or the Gulf area will add more value? I'd appreciate if you can have your comment and also Professor Hamid from his experience.
So my answer is yes. Actually, this is the last line in my conclusion, but probably Professor Hamid can add better than what I can talk.
Okay, I think there's a great opportunity to study the genetic of asthma in this region. And what you have shown is clearly that this region all over the world, that the difficulty in replication because they study different population. If you study the same population, there's no problem. But when you study different population, you know, we have done a study in Canada and we looked to 2,000 genes and only three were replicated in the whole. So I think we have a great opportunity and we have to map our gene in our area here, because eventually, as you have said, it's going to be individualized therapy that will be depending on the gene arrangement and polymorphism. And we should not miss this opportunity in the Gulf area.
Prof. Hamid, it's before you leave from the microphone here. Now, you know that the new policy now, in order to have your data accepted and published, you have to replicate in two different populations. Now, we're contradicting ourselves that if you said that we cannot replicate in another society, however, to get it published, you have to replicate it in two different populations to get published and to be known to other people.
Well, I would just like to add that several years ago, Professor Stephen Holgate was given the King Faisal International Prize in Allergic Diseases. When he was there, this subject was stimulated. And some work was done, preliminary, Professor Alfrey, Dr. Mahanna and all. Maybe it's 1999, 2000, many years ago, but it didn't take off the ground. So I think the idea is very good, and of course, by your input, and Professor Alfrey here and Dr. Mohsin, it can take place and will be very good. By the way, Farasan Island is one example you have to take, and it's a very good, very good example. Next question, please.
Yes, it's for you, Dr. Hassanin. It's regarding the, can you elaborate more about the lack of, I don't know, specificity or sensitivity of the extract, allergic extract, that's giving you some results, you know, to check for patient's allergic status? I think it's alarming to say that whatever, you know, antigen has been used by the standard companies, that we're using in the Gulf are not giving, you know, what you've already checked by immunoplasma.
I do understand. Thank you for this question. In fact, as I mentioned in my conclusion, the last line, that the indigenous allergens may play an important role in the increasing prevalence of asthma and allergies. What I meant by that, for example, America has ambrosia. Ambrosia is one of the very known allergens in America. That's America specific, and alternaria. In Saudi Arabia, we have a weed called Amaranthus, but species is varieties. Now, it is so widespread that I can call it the ambrosia of the United States. Now, our colleagues in the clinic, they're using Amaranthus called pigweeds and other names, cylinder weeds, and we are work, Halima is here, you can correct it from my lab. Now, they say we are using Amaranthus, which is they're using in America. But if you see the pattern of the protein profiles and do the 2D gel, you see the Amaranthus varieties, which is predominantly found in all part of Saudi Arabia, is not the one that we are getting from the United States. The one they have is Retrofluxus. What they have is another species. So they have 4 and 5 species, but none of them include varieties. None of them include Levidus. Levidus is being used in our clinic as well. We looked into the company's name all over the United States, Canada, and Europe. None of them are producing Levidus, as they have no raw material. They have no raw material for varieties. So we are the one producing our own and doing the testing and even making for commercial use in short time. But these variations are the one which can affect. That is one thing. And the second part of your question, that when you purchase from companies, they take some time to come. Sometime you put on table, sometime on bench, then the patient gone is still on there, temperature control and maintains, and within 6 months of time, it loses its potency and allergenicity and antigenicity. Therefore, you may not be able to invoke the SPT result as you wish. So, and you don't do it every day, the 2D gel or SDS page, to see whether they have the protein or not. So it is very difficult, unless you have the fresh material, the reliable company, and you know the total, you know the component. Like, you want varieties, you want varieties. You want Salsola, you have to have a name. So without naming these species, there are cross-reactivities, of course, but only 30% in some group. So you don't rely the 30% cross-reactivity to eliminate one something which is causing 100% problem.
So you mean whatever we're getting as a positive response is due to
Okay, very good. Now, not in all aspect that it is cross-reactive. For example, dust mites. Dust mites are the same as we have here, Farinae and Ternosinus. Cat allergen are the same. So what reactivities you get is correct and right. But when you are looking for Amaranthus varieties and looking to Amaranthus retrofluxus, there is a possibility that you are getting the weak reaction, not a strong reaction, and that is because of the cross reactivity. But the bottom line is that if you intend to desensitize your patient and do immunotherapy, it will not work because it's very, very, very diluted. Therefore, you need to have the precise molecular relationship between the antigen and the desensitizing vaccine. Yes, please.
Thank you, everybody. It was a very comprehensive talk for almost of the topics. My question to Dr. Freha, I have two questions, one to Dr. Freha and one to our dermatologist. In regards to, I don't know, I'm from Medina, actually. I don't know why Medina was overlooked in the study of the pollens. I believe in the future, probably, we will have asthma management will depend upon, I believe this will be the future, depend upon the regional, rather than now we are having the global. But I believe in a time or coming soon that we'll have as a regional. For example, like what Dr. Said mentioned, that the season of the bond, that seasonal asthma is there. So if I know that our patient or having, I know the pollens characteristic in my region, I will be able to at least in regards to immunotherapy, and as well, there is some now increasing evidence of using the singular or the multi-cast as a short course, for example, in the season, the 2 or 3 months, the seasonal, I will use it. Then I will stop. I will not stop the other management of asthma medication, but in this regard. So I will prescribe it for a short period. It is increasing evidence, although that paper was published was biased because it was sponsored by that company. But still, the evidence is increasing. The other part of the question to our dermatologist, because I'll leave the mic, and regard using the anti-staph short courses in patient with severe asthma, especially. Can we use it as a short course in a periodical period of time? It has been there, and people are practicing this, but I couldn't find an evidence.
Thank you very much. I think you made your point very clear. Please, the first question. Yes.
The first question was the prevalence in Medina. It was not included for maybe logistic reasons. So, but I believe that the prevalence is not less than other regions in the country, and I am aware of a study which was conducted in Medina by Dr. Shadley, which resulted in a prevalence of about 15 to 16% among children. I don't know whether the data were published, but that was a verbal communication with Dr. Shadley. He's in Uhud Hospital.
I believe in Medina Mubarak Shifa, Doctor. I believe if you have done it, probably you will confirm something like this.
Okay, our next place will be the Medina, inshallah. We'll do both, all included. Thank you very much, Doctor.
Yeah, there was actually, luckily for me, there was a review article in the recent Journal of American Academy of Dermatology last month on the use of short intermittent topical antibiotics to prevent superinfection. And they emphasized up no more than 10 days use of either the Bactroban, which is the mupirocin, or the fusidic acid. And now there's the newer player on the market, which is Altabax, which covers for the other organisms when it's resistant to the other two. So it's highly encouraged. Systemic antibiotics only when there is a cellulitis or severe infectious process. If you just see bullous impetigo, which is what we usually see, just topical antibiotics are more than enough.
This was the last question, but we have to make an announcement, as the chairman has given me, that the lunch will be available at the amenities center, so please join for lunch, and then amenities center, and then we come back again to convene at 1:30, if I'm right.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much for your patience and attendance. Thank you.
شكرا جزيلا لك ربيع شكرا يعطيك العافية
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. معالي الدكتور عبد الرحمن السويلم عضو مجلس الشورى والذي رعى حفل الافتتاح نيابة عن صاحب السمو الملكي الأمير سلطان بن سلمان بن عبد العزيز رئيس مجلس إدارة مركز الأمير سلمان لأبحاث الإعاقة ورئيس مجلس إدارة جمعية الأطفال المعوقين، المتحدثين الدوليين والمحليين الأفاضل، أيها السادة والسيدات، أيها الحفل الكريم، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. نرحب بكم أيها السادة والسيدات في مستشفى الملك فيصل التخصصي ومركز الأبحاث في حفل افتتاح مؤتمر الرؤية المستقبلية لطب المراهقة في المملكة العربية السعودية، والذي سيعقد على مدار يومين هنا في قاعة الدراسات العليا بمستشفى الملك فيصل التخصصي. نتمنى للجميع التوفيق والنجاح لأعمال المؤتمر وللمشاركين قضاء وقتا مفيدا وممتعا. أصحاب المعالي والسعادة والضيوف، سوف نبدأ حفلنا هذا بآيات من كتاب الله الكريم يتلوها الطالب راشد بن مسعد العتيبي من المعهد العلمي بالدرعية. Your Excellency Dr. عبد الرحمن السويلم, Shura Council Member, Distinguished International and National Speakers, Ladies and Gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh and good afternoon. It is a great pleasure to welcome you all in King Faisal Specialist Hospital and Research Center for the opening ceremony of the future of health for healthcare of adolescents in Saudi Arabia, which will be held for 2 days. And we wish you a successful symposia. Ladies and gentlemen, we will begin our ceremony with a recitation from the Holy Quran, and it will be recited by student Rashid Al-Utaybi.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. قل أأنبئكم بخير من ذلكم للذين اتقوا عند ربهم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار خالدين فيها وأزواج مطهرة ورضوان من الله والله بصير بالعباد الذين يقولون ربنا إننا آمنا فاغفر لنا ذنوبنا وقنا عذاب النار الصابرين والصادقين والقانتين والمنفقين والمستغفرين بالأسحار.
أصحاب المعالي، ضيوفنا الكرام، الكلمة الآن للدكتورة هدى قطان رئيس اللجنة المنظمة للمؤتمر. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to call now Dr. هدى قطان, chairperson of the organizing committee.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. معالي الدكتور عبد الرحمن السويلم عضو مجلس الشورى نائب راعي الحفل صاحب السمو الملكي الأمير سلطان بن سلمان بن عبد العزيز الأمين العام للهيئة السعودية للسياحة والآثار رئيس مجلس إدارة مركز الأمير سلمان لأبحاث الإعاقة رئيس مجلس إدارة جمعية الأطفال المعوقين. مع معالي الدكتور قاسم القصبي المشرف العام التنفيذي لمؤسسة مستشفى الملك فيصل التخصصي ومركز الأبحاث. الضيوف الكرام، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. يسرني في البداية أن أتقدم بخالص الشكر والتقدير لصاحب السمو الملكي الأمير سلطان بن سلمان بن عبد العزيز لتفضله برعاية هذا المؤتمر الذي يعقد لأول مرة في المملكة العربية السعودية، لا بل وفي المنطقة ككل، ليناقش موضوعاً خاصاً بشريحة عزيزة على نفوسنا جميعاً. كما يسعدنا أن يكون مستشفى الملك فيصل التخصصي ومركز الأبحاث حاضناً لهذا الحدث الهام. كما يسرني أن أشكر معالي الدكتور عبد الرحمن السويلم لتواجده بيننا نيابة على الأمير سلطان بن سلمان، ولمعالي الدكتور قاسم القصبي لدعمه المتواصل لنا. إن أهمية هذا المؤتمر تأتي كونه الأول من نوعه في المنطقة، يبحث في قضايا هامة تخص شبابنا وشاباتنا الذين هم عماد مجتمعنا في السنوات القادمة، بعد أن بقيت هذه القضايا بعيدة عن البحث والتحليل. ومما يزيد من أهمية هذا المؤتمر أيضاً، واستناداً إلى العديد من الإحصائيات المنشورة، أن 60% من مجتمعنا في المملكة العربية السعودية هم من الذين تقل أعمارهم عن 18 سنة، وهي نسبة عالية جداً مقارنة مع الكثير من الدول. تتضمن أوراق العمل التي سيتم بحثها وتداولها في جلسات المؤتمر الحلول والأبحاث المتعلقة بالعديد من المشاكل الصحية التي يعاني منها شبابنا وشاباتنا. والاستيفاء هذا الشأن حقه من الأهمية والمتابعة الدائمة. نحن في مستشفى الملك فيصل التخصصي ومركز الأبحاث قسم الأطفال بصدد إنشاء الجمعية السعودية لطب المراهقة، تهتم بإعداد الدراسات والأبحاث المستندة على إحصائيات علمية، ليتم على ضوئها تقديم التوصيات اللازمة لتشخيص العديد من الحالات التي تهم المراهقين. وقد أبدأ أساتذة الطب المراهقة المشاركون في فعاليات المؤتمر اهتمامهم بالمساهمة في إنشاء الجمعية السعودية لطب المراهقة. ولا يفوتني في الختام إلا أن أتقدم للمشاركين في هذا المؤتمر من خارج وداخل المملكة أن يحققوا الفائدة المرجوة من هذا اللقاء بإذن الله. His Excellency Dr. عبد الرحمن السويلم, member of Ashura Council, Vice President of the Chairman of the Disabled Children Association, His Royal Highness Prince Sultan bin Salman bin Abdul Aziz Al Saud, President of the Saudi Commission for Tourism and Antiquities, the Chairman of the Prince Salman Center Disability Research Board of Trustees, and the Chairman of Disabled Children Association Board of Directors. His Excellency Dr. Qasim Al-Qasabi, Chief Executive Director of the General Organization of King Faisal Specialist Hospital and Research Center. Distinguished guests, dear colleague, on behalf of the organizing committee, I would like to welcome you all to the first international conference on adolescent healthcare, the future of healthcare for adolescents in Saudi Arabia. I would like to convey our sincere thanks and appreciation to His Royal Highness Prince Sultan bin Salman bin Abdul Aziz Al Saud for his patronage of this conference, and also many thanks to Dr. Abd Rahman Al-Suwelim for his presence with us today. Saudi Arabia is a nation where the young represented the majority of our population. Statistics approximate that around 60% of our population is in the pediatrics and adolescent age group, that's to say 18 years of age or less. Therefore, this conference is particularly significant for us in order to promote optimal health and well-being for this segment of our society. We are pleased to have the participation and the contribution of world authorities and policy makers, whom I'm sure they will provide us with invaluable information and insights that will have a positive impact on the quality of care provided to our teenagers. I would like to thank all the participants, local and international speakers, for their contributions in our effort to reach our goal of keeping our teens healthy and safe. In closing, I would like to announce that the Department of Pediatric at King Faisal Specialist Hospital and Research Center has been in the process of developing the paradigm for the Saudi Society of Adolescent Medicine that will be committed to ensuring the highest standard of care for youth, creating greater awareness of their health issues, and helping parents understand the healthcare need of their adolescent children. And we hope to announce the launching of this society in the near future. I would like again to thank our international speakers for accepting to be a member of upcoming Saudi Society of the Adolescent Medicine. Thank you very much and goodbye.
شكرا للدكتورة هدى قطان. Thank you, Dr. Qattan. الآن أيها الإخوة والأخوات، يسرني أن أدعو معالي الدكتور قاسم القصبي المشرف العام التنفيذي لإلقاء كلمة. Now I would like to call His Excellency Dr. قاسم القصبي, Chief Executive Director for a speech.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. معالي الدكتور عبد الرحمن سويلم عضو مجلس الشورى نائب راعي الحفل صاحب السمو الملكي الأمير سلطان بن سلمان بن عبد العزيز الأمين العام للهيئة السعودية للسياحة والآثار ورئيس مجلس إدارة مركز الأمير سلمان لأبحاث الإعاقة رئيس مجلس إدارة جمعية الأطفال المعوقين. الحضور الكرام والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. يسرني أن أرحب بمعالي الدكتور عبد الرحمن سويلم والذي يرعى حفلنا اليوم نيابة عن صاحب السمو الملكي الأمير سلطان بن سلمان بن عبد العزيز في حفل افتتاح هذا المؤتمر. كما يسعدني أن أرحب أيضا بالحضور الكرام من داخل المملكة والذين يشاركوننا هذا اللقاء والضيوف الدوليين. مما لا شك فيه أن هذا الملتقى العلمي يكتسب أهمية خاصة لا سيما وأنه يركز اهتمامه نحو مستقبل الرعاية الصحية للمراهقين والمراهقات بالمملكة العربية السعودية والذي يحظى باهتمام من الدولة عزها الله وامتدادا لما توليه القيادة الرشيدة من دعم كبير للخدمات الصحية. إن مستشفى الملك فيصل التخصصي ومركز الأبحاث كمرفق طبي رائد بالمنطقة يفخر باحتضان هذا اللقاء العلمي والذي يعد الأول من نوعه كما ذكرت الزميلة الأخت الدكتورة هدى قطان حيث يتناول قضايا الرعاية الصحية لشريحة غالية على نفوسنا وتشكل حجر الزاوية ولبنة أساسية يرتكز عليها بناء هذه الأمة. ولا شك أن تسليط الضوء على كافة الجوانب المتعلقة بفئة المراهقين وما يتصل بها من ظواهر صحية مثل البدانة والسكر والإعاقة وما يتصل بذلك من جوانب أخرى يأتي ضمن أولويات أروقة هذا الملتقى وسيحظى بقدر وافر من النقاش من قبل المشاركين. وفي هذه المناسبة يطيب لي من هذا المنبر أن أهيب بكافة المؤسسات الحكومية والأهلية والقطاعات التعليمية والإعلامية بدعم البرامج الموجهة لصحة وتثقيف وترفيه شبابنا وشاباتنا آملاً أن تمتد كافة الجهود في هذا الاتجاه من خلال تبني ورعاية البرامج الموجهة لصحة المراهقين وما يتصل بذلك من جوانب ترفيهية وتثقيفية ليسهموا بإذن الله في دفع مسيرة البناء والتنمية والنهوض بها إلى آفاق أرحب. وختاماً آمل أن يسهم هذا اللقاء في تسليط الضوء على آخر المستجدات محلياً وعالمياً في طب المراهقة راجياً أن ينعكس ذلك على ما فيه الصالح العام لمجتمعنا ووطننا الغالي كما لا يفوتني أن أتقدم بالشكر لمعالي الدكتور عبد الرحمن سويلم عضو مجلس الشورى لمشاركتنا هذه المناسبة وإلى أعضاء اللجنة المنظمة ولكل من شارك وأسهم في هذا اللقاء وإلى الضيوف الكرام سائلا الله التوفيق والسداد للجميع والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
ش... شكرا لمعالي الدكتور قاسم القصبي المشرف العام التنفيذي. والآن أيها السيدات والسادة، يتفضل معالي الدكتور عبد الرحمن السوالم بإلقاء كلمة نيابة عن رأي الحفل صاحب السمو الملكي الأمير سلطان بن سلمان بن عبد العزيز.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. معالي الأخ الدكتور قاسم بن عثمان القصبي المدير التنفيذي والمشرف العام على مؤسسة الملك فيصل التخصصي ومركز الأبحاث، الأخت الفاضلة الدكتورة هدى قطان رئيسة اللجنة المنظمة، الضيوف الكرام الإخوة والأخوات، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. يسعدني ونيابة عن صاحب السمو الملكي الأمير سلطان بن سلمان بن عبد العزيز الأمين العام للهيئة العامة للسياحة والآثار ورئيس مجلس إدارة جمعية الأطفال المعاقين ورئيس مجلس إدارة جمعية الأمير سلمان لأبحاث الإعاقة الذي شرفني بافتتاح أعمال هذا المؤتمر نيابة عن سموه، حيث استجد له ظرف طارئ، ولقد كان حريصا على الحضور للمشاركة لما يمثله هذا المؤتمر من اهتمامات سموه في قضايا الشباب وصحتهم وخاصة المعوقين منهم. وفي هذه المناسبة أود أولا أن أعبر عن شكري وتقديري لمؤسسة الملك فيصل التخصصي على اهتمامها بهذه الشريحة من المجتمع من اليافعين، والتي في اعتقادي أنها لم تنل نصيبها من الاهتمام الكافي من القطاع الصحي والطبي في أكثر دول العالم. واليافعون ليسوا أطفالاً ولا هم بالغين كباراً، ونجد الإحراج في التعامل معهم في داخل المستشفيات، كما أن الخدمات التي تخص المراهقين واليافعين لم تأخذ نصيبها من الاهتمام في مجتمعاتنا. فأين هم المتخصصون بهذه الفئة خاصة من أطباء الأسرة والمجتمع؟ ولقد عبر سمو وزير التربية والتعليم عن أسفه بأن خدمات صحة الطلاب دون المستوى المأمول في بلادنا، وذلك قبل أسبوعين. وليس لدينا دراسات وبحوث كافية عن حجم الاحتياجات لهذه الفئة، حيث أن مشاكلهم في تنام، فالسمنة والعنف والمخدرات والحوادث والمتغيرات السيكولوجية في هذه المرحلة من العمر وآثار التفكك الأسري تلقي بظلالها على هذه المشكلة وتزيدها عمقاً. إنني أتطلع إلى مؤتمرات تتبناها مؤسستكم، مؤسسة الملك فيصل، يحضره أصحاب القرار في القطاعات الصحية والعاملون في الصحة المدرسية وأطباء الأسرة والمجتمع، كما أتطلع لدور فاعل للمجتمع المدني، وحيث لا نرى جمعيات علمية ولا جمعيات خيرية تعنى بهذه الفئة. وكم سعدت وسررت أن أسمع من الأخت الفاضلة الدكتورة هدى هذا اليوم الإعلان عن تفكير في إنشاء جمعية لهذه الفئة، وأرجو أن تقبلونني عضوا فيها. إنني لأشكر معالي الدكتور قاسم القصبي ومؤسسة الملك فيصل تبنيها مثل هذا الملتقى ليكون نواة لنشاط فاعل في تلبية وتنامي متطلبات اليافعين في بلادنا، وخاصة المعاقين وأطفال التوحد، والاهتمام بالبرامج الوقائية والاكتشاف المبكر للأمراض والعيادات الاستشارية والتوجيه الإرشادي قبل أن تستفحل الأمراض وتتعقد آثار الانحرافات. فكم نحن بحاجة إلى مثل هذه الندوات والمؤتمرات في كل مناطق المملكة يلتقي فيها الأطباء العاملون والفئات المتعاملة مع هذه الشريحة من المجتمع حتى تنال نصيبها من الرعاية والوقاية والعلاج والتأهيل والإرشاد النفسي والتوجيه لهم ولأسرهم. مرة أخرى أكرر باسمي ونيابة عن صاحب السمو الملكي الأمير سلطان بن سلمان الشكر لمعالي الدكتور قاسم ولمؤسسة الملك فيصل التخصصي هذه المبادرة وللأخت الدكتورة هدى قطان ولزملائها المشرفون على هذا المؤتمر، متمنيا لكم التوفيق والسداد وإلى الملتقى القادم في هذا المسار. أستودعكم الله والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
شكرا لمعالي الدكتور عبد الرحمن السويلم. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the organizing committee would like to recognize our distinguished national and international speakers. And we will start, please. Professor Martin Gripos. Please. Professor David Lau. Professor Charles Irwin. Professor Patricia Simons. Professor Albert Hergenreuder. And now for the national speakers, Dr. Haitham Tafunkeji. Dr. Saleh Al-Rajhi. Dr. Fahad Bamihriz. Dr. Michael Nister. Dr. Fadi Al-Bahiran. Dr. Ismail Al-Badawi.
Thank you.
دكتور إسماعيل. دكتور خالد الزيد. And now the organizing committee also would like to recognize His Excellency Dr. Qasim Al-Khasabi. I would like to present a trophy for him. And also a trophy for His Royal Highness Prince Sultan bin Salman bin Abdulaziz and Dr. Abdurrahman Sualim will have it on behalf of Prince. شكراً لمعالي الدكتور عبد الرحمن السويلم الذي شرف هذا الحفل نيابة عن صاحب السمو الملكي الأمير سلطان بن سلمان بن عبد العزيز. وفي هذه اللحظة أيها الإخوة والأخوات ينتهي حفل الافتتاح، وسوف يستأنف البرنامج العلمي إن شاء الله بعد التوقف للغداء والصلاة. شكراً وإلى اللقاء.